What do the phone in your hand and the fighter jet guarding your skies have in common? They both hold a secret. Buried deep inside them, in their magnets, lasers, and circuits, are tiny amounts of mysterious metals, arguably more precious than gold, known as rare earths. They are the invisible heartbeat of modern life and the silent backbone of national security. Without them, electric cars stall, smartphones go dark, wind turbines freeze, guided missiles miss their targets, advanced fighter jets sit helpless. Even hospitals couldn't run critical machines like MRI scanners. When a single resource is this vital to human society, control over it is the ultimate weapon. And one nation already holds that weapon, China. They control nearly all the world's supply of refined rare earths and command their flow. That grip is power to stall economies and freeze militaries overnight. It's a hidden war, fought not with soldiers, but with supply chains. A new kind of war, where China could cripple rivals without firing a shot, just simply by turning off the rare earth tap. So what exactly are these materials? Why does China hold all the cards? And what happens if they decide to tighten the chokehold? Rare earth elements are a group of 17 chemically similar metallic elements. They fall into two main categories, light rare earth elements and heavy rare earth elements. Despite its name, these materials are not actually rare. They're scattered in tiny amounts within rocks all over the planet. Finding a large enough concentration to make mining profitable is the real challenge. But mining is just the first step. The harder task is separating and refining these elements. They are so chemically similar that separating them into pure, usable metals is incredibly complex, expensive, and extremely polluting due to the use of harmful chemicals. This is where China's dominance becomes clear. While China sits on about 40% of the world's known rare earth reserves, they control a whopping 90% plus of the world's refined rare earth supply. The 90% rate means even when other countries like the US or Australia do the mining, that ore often gets shipped straight to China to be refined into the high purity materials used in products around the world. Why this lopsided control? Most countries simply do not have the infrastructure or the technology required for large-scale refining. Plus, the process is so damaging to the environment that not every country is willing to take the risk. This dependence gives China immense control on the industry. So here's the hard truth. The West mines rocks. China sells capability. But this wasn't always the case. Back in the 1980s, the US was the king of rare earths. The Mountain Pass mine in California pumped out up to 60% of the world's supply. Meanwhile, China had huge reserves, especially in Inner Mongolia's Bayan Obo deposit, but they did not have refining technology and the infrastructure to process them. China could only export its raw ore at rock-bottom prices to Japan or the West, then buy back the refined products at 10 to 100 times the cost. For example, China sold the raw ores containing europium, an element critical for the red color in TV, at $1,400 per ton, then bought back purified europium oxide from US or Japanese firms at around $1,400 per kilogram, a 1,000-fold price increase. That 1,000-fold price gap bled China's resources dry and left it with the environment damaged while others profited. The father of China's rare earths, Professor Xu Guangxian, condemned this imbalance a national humiliation. So what flipped the script? Professor Xu's 1970s solvent extraction method finally let China refine rare earths independently and efficiently. With full state backing, China scaled the technology nationwide. From the 1980s to 1990s, Chinese leaders began investing heavily in research, development, and industrial capacity. It ramped up national production by 300%, prioritizing scale over environmental costs, producing radioactive wastewater at 10 times the US levels. Then came the big move. China flooded the global market with refined materials at prices 20 to 40% below Western competitors. By 2000, China supplied 88% of the world's refined rare earths. And that's when the monopoly kicked in. The impact was devastating for competitors. Western mines simply could not compete with China's prices and lax environmental rules. America's flagship Mountain Pass mine, once the world leader, closed its door in 2002 due to financial pressure and pollution fines. Companies producing stuff that needs rare earths like magnets or batteries faced a choice: import China's cheap materials or move their factories there. However, with China's domestic prices being much cheaper than export prices, combined with low labor costs and market potential, moving to China was the no-brainer. So in the late 90s and early 2000s, big names like Hitachi Metals and MagnaQuench moved their entire production lines to China. This shift usually involves joint ventures, which led to technology transfer. But reality was harsh. Companies chasing profits in China often found their best technology slipping out of their control, or were simply crushed by domestic Chinese companies backed by the Chinese government. Take MagnaQuench, a US company making super strong magnets for weapons like JDAM bombs. Chinese investors bought it in 1995 and 2000. And by 2005, its entire operation was in China. Now, China doesn't just mine or refine. They own the whole chain, from digging up ore to building magnets. They can set the prices and control the supply. Why is it so hard for others to catch up? It's not just the resources. China's refining technology is faster, cheaper, and more efficient than anyone else's. Decades of government funding let Chinese engineers perfect these methods for mass production, which is hard to replicate elsewhere. In December 2023, China banned exports of key extraction technologies, ensuring no one catches up anytime soon. Rare earths have become China's ultimate power play, shaping tech, trade, and the future, all on their terms. But just how powerful is this geopolitical lever? Look at what happened in 2025. In April 2025, China retaliated against new US tariffs by restricting exports of 7 heavy rare earth elements and their magnets. This move hit directly at America's Achilles heel. These 7 elements, especially dysprosium and terbium, are the lifeblood of the world's strongest permanent magnets, used in EVs, wind turbines, and most crucially, advanced defense systems. They are directly tied to the US national security. Fighter jets, submarines, missiles, radar systems, unmanned aerial vehicles, and smart bombs all rely on these 7 heavy rare earth elements. Without them, the US's production line would freeze overnight and prices skyrocket. The production of F-35 Lightning II, America's most advanced stealth fighter jet, would be paralyzed. Lockheed Martin, the aircraft's manufacturer, admitted that there are no substitutes for rare earth elements in more than 16 critical F-35 components. As the Pentagon's own 2023 review warned, shortages could force cannibalization of F-35 airframes for parts within 180 days. The US has no short-term solution for heavy rare earth shortages. Heavy rare earth are much rarer than light rare earth and harder to extract and refine. As of 2023, China accounted for 99% of global heavy rare earth processing. The only operating US mine, the Mountain Pass, which was reopened in 2018, produces only light rare earths. Not to mention it ships 100% of its ore to China for processing. The first US heavy rare earth refinery, MP Materials Texas facility, will not open until late 2027 at the earliest. Linus, the only significant non-Chinese producer of separated rare earths, also refines mostly light rare earths. It does produce some heavy rare earth as byproducts, but scale is small and not its primary focus. This could have triggered a full-blown defense crisis. Then, just 2 months later, in June 2025, the two countries reached a trade agreement. When China resumed approving export permits, the US imports of these metals exploded by 660% overnight, a desperate scramble to refill empty pipelines. But there is an important nuance. Even with a 660% surge, volumes were still 38.7% lower than the same period the year before. By choosing not to fully restore rare earth flows to pre-crisis levels, China showed that it was still in control. It eased pressure just enough to avoid a full-blown collapse while at the same time maintaining a tight grip on leverage. This string of events perfectly reveals China's power and exposes the West's vulnerability. China's power stems more from its processing monopoly and the immense difficulty of replicating that supply chain quickly. While Western nations scramble to build alternatives, creating competing supply chains remains a decade-long marathon, burdened by cost, technical challenges, and environmental trade-offs. For now, China's leverage window stays wide open. Still, does China worry at all? Surprisingly, no. China never planned to control rare earths forever. By dominating this critical input now, it buys crucial time for its companies to dominate the end products that rely on rare earths: electric vehicles, wind turbines, advanced electronics, and military systems. Securing dominance in these massive future markets is worth leveraging the rare earth advantage, even if it fades over time. The real test is timing. Can China cement unbeatable leads in these final industries before its rare earth monopoly weakens? It is a high-stake bet, but so far, it's paying off very well.